Let us start. Let us begin with some questions. See, one question is about can you tell Schrodinger equation of kinetic energy of a particle in a one dimensional box? See, in a one dimensional box, because potential energy is zero. So basically what you are doing is only taking the kinetic energy consideration. If you, even if you take kinetic energy operator, essentially you are trying to find out the eigenvalues only of the kinetic energy operator. So that makes no difference because the potential energy actually is zero in this particular case. Then another question is that, you know, do all electrons except hydrogen atom in one orbit has one wave packet associated with them? See, question is that, you know, for every different quantum number, you have a different wave function, and a different wave function means different wave packet, you know, because what we had been calling as wave packet is something what is equivalent of wave function, and that is what is called wave function in quantum mechanics. So you might have, if you take any book on modern physics, you might have seen these all these wave functions drawn in r theta phi space. So if you are going to any other level, you know what is the wave function, and that is what is the wave packet representing that particular type of state. Now, how the density of particle is maximum at x is equal to L by 2, no, that is what we get from quantum mechanics. So, we cannot probably argue, because once we agree that Schrodinger equation gives me the correct results, or expected to give me the correct result, you know, that is what we obtain from them. So, it is correct that, you know, when you have n is equal to 2, n is equal to 3 state, the maximum position where you have maximum probability of finding the particle will keep on becoming different. Then next question is that if we are studying the wave nature of particle, then in particle in one dimensional potential box, particle in three dimensional potential well, probability to find the particle, why the word particle is used? Well, this is something which is, as I said, is the interpretation, you know, I agree that, you know, it can sort of create a confusion because when we are, let me put it like that, when we say that, when we are talking of the quantum ideas, we are talking of wave being associated with a particular particle. And then eventually we said that this wave is sort of a probability wave, this is not really the type of wave that we are normally used to it, where something physically is vibrating and then you can associate oscillating, and something that we can say that something with physics, you know, here. And then we said that this is a particle, this is a probability wave, and when we are trying to take a particle, see, the fact is that if you are looking at the particle, particle can also be visualized as a particle, and this probability wave actually represents that if you want to, once you perform the experiment, you can try to, you can find out what is the probability of the finding the particle. Of course, this particular thing can also be looked in a slightly different fashion. One can also look at the position operator and take its eigenvalues, and one can also interpret it in a slightly different fashion. But you know, this goes slightly beyond the thing. But I understand that there could be some amount of confusion in this thing. But I hope you one can understand that, you know, a particle can be visualized as a particle also. So when you are talking of this wave associated with that, and once you try to make a measurement on that particular particle, okay, it essentially tries to collapse it to that particular position, and you can always look into this particular fashion. Now, the next question is that in a potential well, if E is equal to V naught, what would be the wave function? You can always solve that particular thing. In fact, one of the gentlemen has, I am not sure, gentleman or lady has sent me a particular thing, which I think is the correct way of, I do not have time to look into it, that, you know, you can always write E is equal to V naught, then you will get d2 psi dx square is equal to 0, and then when you solve the equation, you will get Cx plus d, and then you put the boundary condition that at x is equal to plus infinity, the wave function has to be finite, so it will just be constant. So it can exactly be done like we have been doing normally, there is absolutely no difference in that. Then next question is from some Hindustan Institute of Technology and Management, is about is it quantum mechanically correct that the particle having E less than V have R is equal to 1? I think that we had shown that this actually turns out to be equal to R is equal to 1. So this is correct that it will have a reflection coefficient of 1, there is no net transmission. Okay, please explain a real time problem where the development of Schrodinger wave equation can be used. I mean, whenever you talk of transitions, etc., and all those things, we are using a time-dependent Schrodinger equation. So, I cannot, other than that, I cannot immediately visualize any of the issues where you can show it. Now, let's come to yesterday's lecture, yesterday's questions. There are some questions on crystallography, where we are talking of X-ray diffraction and is the reflection of X-ray from this particular plane. See, as I have been telling that, you know, actually speaking, this is a diffraction phenomenon, but because this refraction phenomenon also obeys this particular condition of specular reflection, which means angle of incidence is equal to angle of reflection. So many times we call it X-ray reflection. one should not get confused about this particular terminology. Actually, it should be accelerated diffraction, okay. But many times people call it not correctly, to be very honest, to call it accelerated diffraction. So, one should not worry about it, so that we understand, so long we understand, this is actually a diffraction phenomenon. The second question was about the Scherer formula, because I had explained about Scherer formula, that about particle size determination. See, thing is that, you know, the question is that calculated from Scherer formula is an average grain size or particle size. But that's what I said, depends on what type of sample you have. Okay, it's if you have a powder sample, this will be particle size. If it's, you know, for example, having a polycrystine, let's say material like it, for example, thin film, this will give you the grain size. If it is an average grain size, try to confirm the size of the nanoparticle from Scherer formula. I mean, this I have always said, one has to take all these things with a pinch of salt. I mean, a large number of students do take use Scherer formula to calculate the average grain size. Okay, let's also be very clear that when we are saying average grain size, we are not very clear what we mean, because the grain sizes are fairly odd in shaped. I mean, you can wash this particular thing using TM, or for that matter, also somewhat from SEM, and you can see that these grains are sort of very, very odd shaped. So how do you define the size? So it's some sort of average which is taken, which gives you the value of Scherer formula. As I said, if this is not exceedingly critical for you, okay, and if you are not looking at a very, very exact value, okay, then you know Scherer formula is a sort of a good estimate of the grain size. I have even said that if you want to calculate the relative grain size, for example, if you want to heat the material and you expect the grain size to increase, and you want to find out how much grain size has increased, okay, these relative changes probably one can get to a reasonable accuracy with Scherer formula. But if it's a really very, very critical for you to find out the grain sizes exactly, okay, or rather average grain sizes exactly, then you know you have to, I mean, the best technique for grain size determination, as I had told you, is the dark field imaging in the transmission electron microscope, which is not very easy, because to make the sample for a transmission electron microscope is not all that trivial job. When people spend weeks to make one sample, and if the sample breaks away, you know, the whole effort goes waste. So it's not that, you know, see, while X-ray can be done very, very routinely, if I prepare 10 samples, I can do for all the 10 samples X-ray today and get the idea. But if I have to take a TM of all these 10 samples, you know, I mean, I'll spend a huge amount of time. So one has to really make a judicious choice when you are doing research to find out, you know, how critically you need that particular information. And if you need it critically, then probably it's worth spending that much time. If all that you want to have an idea as a sort of estimate, okay, then Scherer formula is probably all right. As I said, that a large number of research papers still use Scherer formula to calculate the average grain size. But I have also told you that, you know, things like stresses, etc., could also change the, can also broaden the lines. Okay, while when I am using Scherer formula, I am sort of assuming that this, you know, the width is purely because of the finite grain size and there is no other effect. So there are a lot of, you know, ambiguities there. But as I said, people still do it because, you know, they don't want to use, I mean, it's getting that information is not very critical for them. All they want is a sort of an estimate of what is the typical grain size. Okay, so the next question is that in crystallography for body-centered cubic, you have shown that the position vector A has a negative sign with I. Okay, that's actually correct. I mean, of course, I told you that there are multiple ways of defining primitive vectors of any lattice. So for BCC also, you could have taken a slightly different type of primitive vectors, which would have also served the purpose equally. But on the other hand, you know, I mean, this is the convention that people use it. This convention has been, I mean, because it gives you a certain amount of symmetry in the way A, B, C are represented. So this is what is generally taken, but nothing will change if you decide to take a different set of primitive vectors. Okay, now there are some questions on relativity. So let's start with these questions on relativity. First question is that what is the difference between special theory of relativity and general theory of relativity? As I mentioned, special theory of relativity, we are dealing only with inertial frames. General theory of relativity is much more complex, where we are sort of also including non-inertial frame of reference. That is also an attempt to explain gravitation, and it talks about, you know, I mean, basically, it looks at that what the inertial mass, as we call it, and see, there are two masses which we come, which is one which I forgot the name of the other thing, which comes in the Newton's law of motion, F is equal to ma, another which comes into the gravitational constant gmm upon r square. The fact that these two masses turn out to be exactly identical, it's essentially based on that particular concept. So, I mean, it's much more complex, so, but at least at the moment we can understand the difference is that special theory of relativity talks only of those frames which are inertial frame of references, and while general theory of relativity in a slightly different fashion tries to take into account the non-inertial frame of references also. Then there is some question about the, I think there are two or three questions that I thought, you know, people got a little confused by what I said. See, when I was discussing in the first lecture of relativity, I had only talked about what was being thought about 100 years back or more than 100 years back before special theory of relativity came as the correct thing. But as I will be showing in today's lecture, this is something which actually Einstein objected. In fact, there is nothing like ether. There is nothing, none of these things can be shown. In fact, we will discuss the Michelson-Morley experiment today and talk about the results of this particular thing. So, that particular transparency, what I have used the concept of ether and say that ether can be treated as an absolute rest and all those things, this was all the thoughts which were before special theory of relativity. Okay, those thoughts are no longer believed to be correct. So, we should not get confused, because there are a lot of questions where people have been asking, is it that ether is is absolute rest and things like that. See, I mean, in today's, the way we understand world today, there is nothing like ether. We cannot define velocities, absolute velocities. Okay, we have to define velocities only with respect to something real. Okay, you have to erect your frame of reference on something real, and only then you can talk about the velocities. In fact, this is a point about which I am going to discuss about it. Speed of light is c in ether, and in other frames it's different. You know, again, I was telling that this is what was being thought earlier. Okay, in fact, this aspect I will be discussing more in detail today. Then we have said in relativity we take frame s moving along plus axis. Can we take along y and z axis? Of course, you can take it. The equations will turn out to be different. Okay, so long we have the frames of references are supposed to be inertial frame of reference, you can always in principle choose your x, y, z axis. Only thing, in fact, x, y, z direction can also make arbitrary angle with respect to x, y, x prime, y prime, z prime directions. Only thing, the mathematics will become much more complicated, and you will realize that relativity already there is a lot of mathematics. So, you would like to choose certain system, you know, which at least makes your mathematics easier. So, as a convention, we have always assumed that relative velocity is along the x direction. But in fact, there have been some problems where you can even talk about relative velocity being in the y direction. There is nothing wrong. You can things are to be only written in a different fashion, but otherwise it's perfectly all right. Now, what would be the consequence if there is no limit of velocity of light as special theory of relativity mentions? Actually, unfortunately, I will not be able to talk about this particular limit in great detail. The first and most important consequence that you will get that all these distances, etc., will turn out to be imaginary. And you know, we do not know what you mean by imaginary time, we do not know what is meant by imaginary distances. So, as I said, anything which is observable should be real, and that is one of the reasons why we do not expect the velocity is greater than the velocity of light. But there is also another thing which is we call the causality, the phenomenon of causality. See, we always feel that cause should precede the outcome. So, for example, if I throw a ball to somebody, then the person receives the ball only because somebody has thrown the ball. So, throwing the ball was the cause and outcome was that another person receives the ball. Now, obviously, this particular outcome should come later. Okay, it should not happen that in a particular frame of reference, one can observe that the ball is received first but thrown later. So, this is what is called causality. One can also show that if the speed is greater than speed of light were allowed, then causality will be violated. It means it may be possible in that particular case that you could have some frame of references where cause appears later and its outcome appears first. So, you first know that the person has received the ball and you will notice that the ball has been thrown. So, this is something which sort of is not acceptable. So, that is another reason why we do not allow speeds greater than the speed of light, because as we say that this will violate causality. Then there is a question is that as we know, nobody is at rest in the universe, but it is mentioned. So, again I have said that rest is, this concept of absolute rest was being talked only in the sense of classical mechanics, I mean not classical mechanics, but the classical ideas when we thought that ether exists. But you know, now we know that ether doesn't exist, there is nothing like ether. Okay, so those particular things, whatever I have mentioned in first lectures, has to be taken as the things, the thoughts which were before special theory of relativity. As I had mentioned, that my first way is to tell why relativity was needed, where I had my weak points, weak arguments, that's what I had discussed in that particular lecture, that the concept of ether was introduced, but people were not very happy with that particular concept. Because in mechanics, if you have a pure mechanical phenomenon, you find that all inertial frames are equivalent, but it seems to be showing that when you are coming to electromagnetic theory, all the frames do not appear to be equivalent, which is something is not very easily, and people are not happy with that particular situation. And that's why, and of course, eventually, as I said, they have to perform an experiment and see that whether this concept of ether is really correct or not. And that's what I'm going to discuss, that this does not turn out to be correct. In relativity, we take two inertial frame. Can we take two non-inertial frame? No, not in the special theory of relativity. Special theory of relativity, it always means that the two frames, it means applicable only when the two frames are inertial. Can we say that Earth is inertial or non-inertial? That also I had mentioned last time, that strictly speaking, there is no really a 100% inertial frame exists. Okay, in fact, these are all idealized concepts, and there is nothing like which is 100% ideal anywhere in life or universe. Okay, but Earth is actually, everyone knows that it's a non-inertial frame of reference. It's not only undergoing orbital motion across about the sun. Okay, it means its velocity keeps on changing as a function of time. It's also spinning about its own axis, and that spinning is also fairly complex, as all of you know. Okay, so all these problems definitely makes the Earth as a non-inertial frame of reference. But as also I discussed yesterday, that the effect of these non-inertial frame of references generally for many of the phenomena will be negligible, and therefore most of the time when we are observing a phenomenon on Earth, we could treat Earth as an approximately inertial frame of reference. Then there is a question, is that Earth is assumed to be inertial, then what will be the impact on special theory of relativity? As I said, in general, in any mechanics, if you are having a non-inertial frame of references, you may have to introduce some pseudo forces. I'm not sure special theory of relativity whether it will cause certain specific changes, because special theory of relativity sort of assumes them to be inertial frame of references. Then there is another question, can frame S double prime move along y z axis, which I have just now explained that it's possible to do it. So I think this takes care of all the questions. So let's now come back to my the second lecture on relativity. Okay, so this is what we had discussed last time, that it was felt that consistency of electromagnetic theory with relative velocity expression required the presence of a special inertial frame, which was termed as ether. Okay, in fact, I had mentioned, and today morning again I have mentioned, that this concept is was sort of not very happily accepted, but people thought that this is the only way out under the classical mechanics. But then we needed experiment to support whether really ether exists. So this is what I am going to discuss, whether there is an experimental support to the factor to the fact that ether really exists. Okay, so this is what I am going to discuss today, which we call as a Michelson and Morley experiment. But let us first discuss, before we start discussing actually the Michelson and Morley experiment, what is the logic behind that experiment, how this experiment was thought, what was the thought process behind this particular experiment, and then we will talk about the actual experiment. So basically, what is our idea? This is what I want to prove, that I want to measure, if the concept of ether is correct, then if I take two different frames of reference, okay, then you should measure different speeds of light. Okay, because we said that is only in ether that the speed of light is given by c is equal to 1 upon under root epsilon naught mu naught. If you go to a different medium, the velocity of light will be different, as it is governed by the normal relative velocity formula. Okay, which is standard, as we said. I have given an example last time, that if you are sitting in a train, you find the speed of the train which is approaching to you or which is going away from you to be different. Okay, same thing would normally you would expect to be for the velocity of light in the realm of classical mechanics. Okay, so it means if you are going to two different frames of reference, you should be able to measure two different speeds like a classical particle. That's what I am able to do it. Okay, so then that will confirm the confirmation of the existence of ether in which the speed of light is this. So, this is basically I want to do. If I am able to measure the speed of light to be different in two different inertial frame of references, then I have actually at least partly I have explained the fact that probably that ether exists and probably the velocity of light is a frame dependent quantity. Let us see whether this works out or not. So, this is the plan of the experiment, you know, how you thought about it. So, this blue thing, you know, I have put it here. Let us assume that this is some body, okay, I will call it Earth a little later, okay, which is moving with a speed v and there is a light beam which is approaching it, okay. Now, when we are defining v, let us be clear, we are not biased about it, that this v as well as this c is are both relative to our ether. So, as we have said that according to the classical ideas, the speed of light c should be dependent on the fundamental constants 1 upon epsilon naught mu naught only when the medium is ether. This is what was classical thought. Okay, I am repeating, unless people have confusion about these things, as I said, these are all classical ideas. Okay. So, let us assume that there is an ether medium which exists and therefore, this particular speed of light c will be given by under root 1 upon epsilon naught mu naught in this particular medium and this particular body is travelling with a speed v again as measured in ether medium. Now, question is that what will be the speed of light that will be measured by an observer sitting in this particular row, okay. And of course, at this particular moment, only thing which I have is the classical relative velocity formula. So, I will apply classical relative velocity formula to find out what will be the speed of this light when measured in this particular frame of reference. As you can very easily see that if the observer is sitting here, that particular person will not notice his or her own speed. So, actually the velocity of this particular light as seen in this particular medium will be vector c minus vector v. So, this is what I am trying to essentially assert on this particular thing. So, the measured velocity of light in the object frame would be given by this I have put m, which means the measured velocity will be given by c minus v. This v was in ether medium, this c was also in ether medium, all right. But now I have changed my frame of reference. I applied the classical relative velocity formula, which essentially says that whatever is the velocity of this particular frame of reference of this particular object, okay, that must get subtracted vectorially, subtracted from the velocity. So, if I measure the speed of light when I am sitting on this particular frame of reference or this particular object, then I would measure a velocity c minus v. Now, I have drawn two figures here in this particular case, where I have used exactly the same length of c, exactly same length of v. I have even maintained the same direction of v. I have only changed the direction of c. So, in this particular case, this is value of c. In another case, this is the value of c. Okay. Now, I take a vector difference of c minus v. As you can see very easily, in this case, this will be the velocity of light which will be measured. And in this particular case, the velocity of light, this will be the value of velocity of light which will be measured. So, now you can see very easily if this would have been the direction of c, remember the c and v are constants in magnitude, okay, not in direction. Okay. Now, c and v magnitude wise are constant, but still the vector difference of them, this vm, its magnitude would be different depending upon what is the direction of c. Okay, so, if c keeps on changing, if the direction of c keeps on changing, then in this particular object frame, we will not only find that the direction of this particular light velocity will be different, but we will also notice that its magnitude will be different even though the magnitude of c and magnitude of v are identical. So, this is basically the thing which I want to mention because this is key to understanding the Michelson Morley experiment. So, I have emphasized that velocity, object velocity is same in both the figures. In fact, the magnitude of c is also same in both the figures. So, this is what I have said, the magnitude and direction of the measured velocity would depend on the direction of velocity of light. Hence, if we measure velocity of light in object frame in different direction, they would in general be different. If whatever I am saying is correct, okay, let me re-emphasize, this is purely from the classical ideas. Whatever I am going to say, I am going to contradict later once I talk about special theory of relativity.
So you should not have confusion that what I am trying to say is correct. These are purely classical ideas which are going to be rejected. Okay. So if whatever I am saying classically would have been true, then what I will do in object frame, if I am sitting, if I measure speed of light in different directions, they will turn out to be different from magnitude point of view. Their magnitude will also turn out to be different because of the figure which I have shown here, that these magnitudes will be different depending upon in which direction I measure the velocity of light. All right. So if I choose a particular frame of reference, O frame of reference, and I measure the speed of light in different directions and I find them to be different, it means they are, I mean, in one way I have said, I have not directly proved that ether exists, but I have at least shown that velocity of light is frame dependent. Though I am making the measurement exactly in the same frame, okay, but at least it becomes consistent with the idea of ether that the velocity of light c has a particular value only in the ether medium. So let us consider a very special situation. That is the situation which was actually utilized by Michelson and Morley. So let us assume two different situations, one which the measured velocity, remember it is measured velocity Vm. Okay, I do not know what is the direction of c because I do not know when I am sitting on object O, I do not notice my own velocity. Okay, so I can only measure with respect to, I erect some axis along xyz direction. So what I will do, I will measure in two different directions. Okay, so let us assume two different situations, one in which the measured velocity in the object frame is along the velocity, another in perpendicular to it. So let us visualize this particular type of situation that suppose I have this particular, how actually it will be done, it will be, I will show it later. But let us suppose that we have situation in which I am trying to measure in two different directions, okay, and in one direction it is v is perpendicular, the measured velocity of light is perpendicular to the direction of v, another it is in the same direction. Of course, as I just now say, if you are sitting on the earth frame of reference or that object frame of reference, you do not know your velocity, okay. How we will solve this particular problem, let us postpone it till the next at a later point. But let us assume at this particular moment, suppose I am looking it from ether medium or from outside medium, okay, and then I know that this particular object, person sitting on the object is actually performing an experiment in which the velocity of light is being measured in a direction perpendicular or parallel to the velocity direction. So let me just make this particular situation clear. So let us suppose this is being observed from ether medium, this is moving at the velocity v, okay, and I feel sitting here that this particular person is observing the velocity in a direction perpendicular. So, he is measuring velocity in a direction perpendicular to v. This person would be able to measure velocity in a direction perpendicular to this particular v only if c is moving in this particular direction, because the person what he would notice the velocity, or she will notice the velocity of the or the direction of velocity will be c minus v. Okay. So, according to the person sitting on this particular object frame of reference, the velocity will be measured perpendicular to v only when this vm is in perpendicular direction to v and not when it is perpendicular to this c direction. So, this is what has to be very, very clear, that if this particular person has to measure in a direction perpendicular to v, then this has to be value of c, so that what this person is going to measure is only c minus v. Similarly, if the person is going to measure the velocity, the speed of light in this particular direction, of course, c has to be traveling only in this particular direction. Now, my question is that, can I calculate what would be the value of this particular velocity, what would this particular velocity in case this particular object wants to measure velocity of light in a direction perpendicular to the direction of v and along the direction of v. So, let us first look at the perpendicular situation. So, in perpendicular situation, this has to be direction of c as I just now discussed. This is the direction of the object and this is vm perpendicular. This is measured in a perpendicular direction. So, if he has to measure vm, and remember c is what is given by the fundamental constants and v is the velocity of the object relative to ether. Okay. So, as we have said, vm must be equal to c minus v. So, I just calculate what will be the magnitude. Of course, this is a right angle triangle. So, you can very easily see that the magnitude of this square is equal, must be equal to magnitude of this square minus magnitude of this square. But if you are not very happy, you can take the dot product of these two. If you take dot product, you will get c square plus v square minus 2 c dot v, and you can again show that c dot v will actually equal to v square, because you know, you just take c dot v, this will give you again a component along this particular direction. This will be C multiplied by V multiplied by cos theta, and C cos theta will, because of this figure, will again give you V. So this will become V square. Otherwise, you can directly look at this triangle. Okay. So this particular length must be equal to C square, this particular arm square minus this particular arm square. So this particular thing should be equal to C square minus V square, because I am looking only at the magnitudes here. Now, in a parallel situation, things are much more simpler. If you have a parallel situation, remember this C is only in the ether medium according to my earlier thinking, and this is the V here. So actually V parallel will be smaller than this thing, because Vm parallel must be, I should have put Vm here, Vm parallel must be equal to C minus V, all right. So because this has to be the difference of these two, as we have always been telling, so this particular measured velocity will turn out to be smaller than this thing, because you know this is what is actually the V. Alright. So this will be, this will get, they are in the same direction, so they just get subtracted by the magnitude of V. Okay, now we look actually at the Michelson Morley experiment. So as we said that we do not know immediately the direction of V, but you can perform by taking some directions, you can perform at various seasons, you can keep on rotating. I mean, there are various ways of doing it. We will see that, you know, how this particular person, they perform this particular experiment. But let us assume at the moment that I am able to measure a velocity of light in a direction perpendicular to V and parallel to V. Okay, let us just assume that we can do it. Okay, in case it does not work out, we will always try to, I mean, we will always keep on making modification. I will explain this particular thing. I think let us first go about this particular small mathematics, then we will discuss it about it more detail. So, using above idea, Michelson Morley designed and performed experiment to test ether hypothesis. So, let us first ignore, because I am performing this experiment on Earth, so let us ignore all the motions of Earth other than the orbital velocity, and let us assume that this orbital velocity is also constant. Okay, basically I am assuming Earth to be an inertial frame of reference. Okay, so you are ignoring the spin of the Earth, you are ignoring the fact that actually orbital velocity is changing its direction. Okay, it is not constant. So let us assume that this is only a constant velocity V relative to ether. Okay, let us see what is the effect of this particular thing. So, the experiment performed was something like this, that you have a source of light, okay, then you have a half silvered mirror. So, light beam comes here and this is put at an angle of 45 degrees with respect to this particular beam. So, you find that half of the light is reflected here, while half the light, approximately half the light gets transmitted. Then you have a mirror here, the light gets reflected from this mirror, then again part of the light starts coming here. Of course, part of the light will get reflected, which I do not care at this moment. Then similarly, the light which has been transmitted here with respect to this M, from this M1, they will get reflected. When it gets reflected, again part of the light will be reflected, part of the light will be transmitted. I do not bother about the transmitted light, I bother about the reflected light. So once I see this particular beam, that is what is of interest to me, because that is where I have put my telescope to observe. So what you will find that this particular light, which is going this way and coming back, will come here. This light which is coming back from here will also come back here. These two lights will interfere, and if we perform the experiment in a proper way, by slightly tilting these mirrors, you will be able to get the interference fringes. And using these interference fringes, we can find out, I mean, that was the idea, we can find out that is there a path difference. I mean, we try to make these lengths more or less same. So you look at the path difference and try to find out what happens to the interference fringes. So this is basically the experiment. Of course, in this case I am assuming that this direction is parallel to V, this direction is perpendicular to V, which as I said may not be immediately obvious. Okay, but on the other hand, I mean, this experiment can be performed at various different seasons. Okay, this particular experiment can also be rotated. In fact, Michelson Morley actually rotated the experiment because of some other reasons. Okay, so all those things, you know, can be taken care of by in a proper way. So as of now, for calculation, let us assume that this direction is actually the direction of Earth's velocity in ether medium, and this is the direction which is perpendicular to the velocity of Earth in Earth ether medium. So now I have just now shown that the velocity, if this is direction which is perpendicular to V, then the velocity in this particular medium will be under root C square minus V square. You can also show exactly in the same fashion which I am not showing, doing exactly the same type of calculation, that if it was going backwards, then also its velocity will be c square minus v square. So, according to observer sitting on earth, okay, the velocity of light will travel up with speed c square minus v square and will again travel downwards with the same velocity c square minus v square. But if this is the direction of velocity of earth, we have seen that in this particular direction the velocity of light will be c minus v. But when I am going in this particular direction, because now I am going opposite to the velocity of the earth, my velocity will be c plus v, exactly the type of thing that we have said in the case of now train compartments, that if the train is approaching you, the velocity will turn out to be larger than you. So, this is applying basically the old standard classical relative velocity formula. So, this is what you will be getting. So, now you can calculate what will be the time taken by the light to go here and come back here, and what will be the time taken by the light to go here and come back here, okay, and therefore, you can calculate what will be the path difference. So, I will just sort of hurry through these particular transparencies. Calculation of the phase difference. If t parallel was time taken for the light to travel to and fro from the parallel arm of the length, okay, which is this particular arm of the length, okay, in one direction it will be c minus v, in another direction it will be c plus v. Okay, so, if you take this particular thing, just calculate this thing, you know, denominator will become c square minus v square, then just take this particular thing, you will get that this time will turn out to be 2L by c, where L is the length of this particular arm. Okay, multiplied by 1 minus 1 divided by 1 minus v square by c square. So, this will be the time taken by the light to travel in the parallel arm. Parallel means parallel to the velocity direction of earth in ether medium. Similarly, I can calculate t perpendicular. Okay, let us just this t parallel, I have sort of approximated it because generally v's are supposed to be much smaller than c. So, this 1 upon 1 minus 1 v square by c square, I can write this to the power minus 1, and then expand this into binomial series, and then you will get this approximately, this will become 1 minus nx, n will be equal to minus 1. So, this becomes plus 1. So, this is approximately will be equal to 2L upon c 1 plus v square by c square. Now, let us calculate in the perpendicular direction. In perpendicular direction, velocity going upward and coming down is exactly the same. So, the light will travel total distance of 2L, L going up, L coming down with the same velocity c square minus v square. So, t perpendicular will be 2L upon under root c square minus v square. So, I calculate exactly the same thing. Then you calculate what is t perpendicular, use exactly the same thing, take this to the power minus half, then there will be a minus sign will get changed because of this minus half power, and because there is a half, so this will turn out to be factor of 2 here. So, you can see that because of this particular 2 square, the time taken by the light to travel in perpendicular direction, okay, will turn out to be slightly smaller. So, therefore, there will be small time difference between the light travelling on the right hand direction, I mean on the parallel direction and the perpendicular direction, which will cause a phase change. Okay, once it causes a phase change, we can calculate how much will be the phase change. First, we calculate the time difference, which is t parallel minus t perpendicular. This time difference will be given by this thing. This I am sort of moving a little faster because you can always, this is a simple calculation. Now, we have to observe fringes. Of course, you know, if the path differences are, you know, there is small amount of difference of path difference, that does not really give you immediately the fringes. So, what you do, that your mirrors you make slightly tilted, so that different portions of the light, you know, which are getting reflected from these two mirrors, they also have small phase shifts. Therefore, you are able to see the interference fringes. So, here you slightly tilt here, you are slightly tilted. So, you have a beam of light which is coming here. So, because of slight tilting, there will be small amount of phase differences which will be coming, because the light is, some light is getting reflected from here, some light will be getting reflected slightly from a different place. So, that the distance travelled will be slightly more. So, there will be continuous phase differences over the entire beam, and therefore, what you will be see will be the interference fringes. But in addition to this, there will also be a path difference, because of the distance, different time which has been taken by the light to travel the two distances. So, this is what I said. If mirrors M1 and M2 are slightly inclined, they would create a gradual phase shift and one would observe a fringe pattern in the telescope. The time difference in arrival of the waves in the two arms would cause an additional phase difference. But biggest problem is that, you know, okay, it will cause phase difference, so you will probably find a fringe, I mean if this particular experiment would have really given you that particular phase difference, you will find a fringe shift. But how do you notice this fringe shift? Because all you will see is the fringe pattern. When you shift the fringe pattern, you will not be able to really know. You do not know where is the zero. Okay, if you know that this was the fringe pattern and because of this additional phase difference, fringe pattern has shifted this much, then you could have noticed it. Okay, but this, you do not know the way the experiment has been done. So then Michelson and Morley had this idea that, you know, why don't you keep on rotating this particular setup. So you keep on rotating the setup. So they have developed a huge platform. For this experiment is a very, very interesting experiment. If you look at the historical aspect of this particular experiment, this particular entire setup was being rotated. So let us look at this particular situation. Okay, originally this particular arm was arm 1 and this was originally arm 2. So original, this arm 1 was in a direction parallel to V, and this particular arm 2 was in a direction perpendicular to V. Now, when I have rotated it by, let us say, 90 degrees, then this particular arm 1 has become in a direction perpendicular to it, and this particular arm 2 has now become in a parallel direction. So, whatever was the time taken by the light in this particular position, in going this way from this particular way in arm 1, now will become different. Now, what was the time taken by arm 2? This particular configuration will become again different here. So, what was time taken by 1 now will be taken, will be the time taken by in the second arm. Okay, whatever was the time, okay, this was the original situation. So, whatever was the time taken by the light to go from this way to this way in this arm, same time will now be taken by this particular arm 2 here. And whatever was the time being taken by light to go up here and come down, okay, the same time difference will be taken by now in arm 1, because now it is arm 1 which has become perpendicular. So, essentially what you have happened, your phase difference has just shifted. So, originally parallel was larger and this T perpendicular was smaller. So, this was, you can write T parallel as T1 and this is T2. So, originally T1 minus T2 was positive, now T2 minus T1 will become positive. Okay, so as we are gradually changing, you will find that the phase difference will change from this particular quantity to minus of this particular quantity. Alright, because initially it was T1 minus T2, now it becomes T2 minus T1. So, if I take the total fringe shift, it will be total time delay upon rotating by 90 degree will be delta T minus delta T. I hope this particular point is clear, because you know, now the time difference takes negative sign. So, in originally in arm 1 it was taking more time, in original arm 2 it was taking less time, now in arm 1 it is taking less time, original time 2 it will be taking more time. So, when you are taking the difference, now difference has just become negative of that. So, overall thing, as I am keeping rotating, you will find out that the time delay will change from delta T to minus delta T. So, total time delay has been this particular thing. This you must divide by the time period, which is 1 upon frequency. 1 upon frequency is actually, you divide this becomes C by lambda. Okay, so you can actually calculate what will be the overall fringe shift. Overall fringe shift will turn out to be this much. Okay. So, this is divided by, as we said, time period. When you divide by time period, essentially means multiplied by frequency. Multiplying by frequency means multiplying by C by lambda. Okay, so this will be overall fringe shift. Now, these parameters I have taken from some book. Okay, so, in one of the original experiments was of this length was not very large, it is very interesting, 11 meters. This was the lambda which was used, and we assume the velocity from whatever we have some idea about what will be the orbital velocities. Okay, I think this is again unit problem, so I will change this particular thing. Okay, no, sorry, it is V is 10 to the power minus 4 C, V is equal to 10 to the power minus 4 multiplied by the velocity of light, I am sorry, 10 to the power minus 4 times the velocity of light. If you take this particular thing, substitute in this particular expression, then the overall fringe shift that you will be getting is approximately 0.5. Now, in fact, they had done a very good error analysis, Michelson and Morley, and they are very, very sure that this 0.4 fringe shift would be observable by them. But unfortunately, they could not observe. They performed this experiment in various seasons to be very sure. Okay, and of course, we are always rotating. So, my original arm was not really parallel to V. Once I have rotated at one particular angle, it will at least become parallel to it, and you are continuously rotating. So, at least one direction, it will always be parallel to V. okay, and the other arm will be in perpendicular direction to V. So even if in my original, when I start this particular experiment, my arm may not be really parallel to it, but when as I keep on rotating, at one time it will become parallel to it. So let us start that my, as my T is equal to 0 position, okay. Then you are not very sure, you try to do it again a different season when you know that Earth's motion about the sun has changed its direction of V. So the velocity of V has changed its direction with respect to ether. Okay, so this experiment was performed in number of ways and we never found any fringe shift. Okay, of course these days this experiment, you know, much later than these experiments are performed with much better and better accuracies, and the final result was exactly identical. You never observed any fringe shift. It appeared as if the path difference that we have calculated, okay, by assuming the velocity of light to be different in two different direction. Okay, assuming that velocity of light is c only in ether medium, and because Earth is moving in ether medium, therefore you will find the velocity of direction in two velocity of light in two different directions to be different. Okay, that particular hypothesis does not work. This is what I call as a failure of experiment. Experiments are performed in various seasons but never give positive results. Various unsatisfactory reasons were also floated to explain the negative results. There are a lot of people try to explain various reasons that why this particular experiment was not successful, because people were always bound with that particular idea, people always were bound with that particular thought process. There are also some other series of experiments where people try to calculate the force on a charged particle in the magnetic field, because, you know, as we say that it depends on V cross B, and of course thought at that time was that V was velocity in ether's medium. Okay, so if you, for example, move to a particular in a different frame of reference and you measure the force on that particular charge, okay, that should turn out to be different if this hypothesis of ether medium is correct. So there have been some other attempts based on the use of electromagnetic theory. A moving charge in Earth may produce a magnetic field, or such, or for example, you know, if Earth is moving let's say ether medium, okay, then V, even if this particular charge is stationary on Earth, okay, then actually it's moving in ether medium, okay. Therefore, there should be a magnetic force on this particular thing, because it should be V cross B, okay. So if I apply a magnetic field, okay, even if the charge is stationary, in principle it should experience a force, because actually this charge is moving in ether medium, okay. None of these experiments were found successful. Then came the postulates of special theory of relativity in 1905, as all of you know. These are the two postulates of Einstein, okay. They were very, very bold postulates, and what was outcome of these particular things were equally bolder. And as I have told you last time, it was not very easily acceptable. Even the citation of Nobel Prize for Einstein did not mention special theory of relativity, even though this particular thing was given to him more than 10 years later after the advent of special theory of relativity. Okay, so these are the postulates of special theory of relativity. The first postulate is, laws of physics are same in all inertial frame of reference. No preferred inertial frame exists. Okay, Einstein was a very, very non-orthodox thinker. He could think out of the blues. You know, he can really think something very, very different. And he said that there is no reason why phenomenon in mechanics should be different from the phenomenon in electromagnetic theory. Okay, if from pure mechanics we find all inertial frames to be equivalent, they should also be equivalent even from the point of view of electromagnetic theory. So very, very clear that all laws of physics are same in inertial frame of references. So long you are talking of an inertial frame of reference, okay, you will always have exactly, you can apply all laws, whether they are based on pure mechanical phenomenon or based also on electromagnetic theory, they should all remain identical. They will not change. There is no preferred inertial frame. There is nothing like ether. Okay, you do not talk of any frame of reference which is special, okay, and talk that you are talking of velocity of light only in that particular medium. But then you have a huge issue. The issue is that, as I have just now discussed, if you believe that all inertial frames are equivalent, which as I have even told you yesterday, you would have liked to believe it, okay, because I have given an argument that all mechanicals, from mechanics point of view, that all frames turned out to be equivalent, okay. How is it so that the nature has made a bias towards a mechanical phenomenon, that from the point of a mechanical thing, now you find all the inertial frames of equivalent, but when it comes to electromagnetic theory, you can distinguish between various inertial frames of references. So this he did not find, Einstein did not find it acceptable. So he made a bold postulate saying that no preferred inertial frame exists. But then this becomes inconsistent with the velocity addition formula, because then what will happen? C will turn out to be frame dependent quantity, and if C turns out to be frame dependent quantity, then my fundamental constants also become frame dependent. So he makes a second postulate, which is also very, very important postulate. The speed of light C is same in all inertial frame of reference. It's not very certain whether Einstein knew about the Michelson and Morley experiment's outcome. See, this particular paper, Special Theory of Relativity, I was told, does not contain any reference. It was really an original work. I was also told that there's some reference, that there had been some experimental evidences. But the fact is was that in its own self, it was an exceedingly bold statement, which says that speed of light cannot be frame dependent. In all inertial frame of references, you will measure the same speed of light. What does it mean? This postulate implies that there is no absolute rest, first postulate. No absolute velocities. I can never talk about absolute velocity. There is no ether. The space is filled with nothing. There is nothing like ether. Okay, when electromagnetic wave travels, it actually travels in space. Okay, without being occupied, that space is not occupied in something. Okay, we require something real to which we can attach frame of reference. Then only with respect to that frame we can talk of velocities. So whenever I am sitting at some place, with respect to that particular place, I can talk about the velocities. Okay, but I cannot talk about the absolute velocities. Okay, so there is nothing like ether with respect to which I can always talk about the velocities. All right. For example, I mean, when I am sitting on Earth, I can always talk about the velocities of, let's say, train, plane, or you know, car. Okay, okay. Assuming that this is relative to Earth. Okay, but such type of liberty does not exist in overall nature. Okay, you have to always talk with respect to something real. Okay, when you are talking of the velocities of galaxies or a particular star, okay, you have to specify when you are talking velocity, it's with respect to what. What does the second postulate imply? That this is a figure which I had drawn earlier yesterday, okay, and I had mentioned that the velocity of light measured by the two persons here will be different. Now, the second postulate means that this person, this person, this person, all three of them will measure the same speed of light c. So, whether this person approaches this particular source of light, whether this person recedes from this particular approach of source of light, this person, person sitting on Earth, all three will measure exactly the same speed of light c. Okay. This will not obey c minus v or c plus v. All the observers will measure the same speed of light. So, the second postulate, if we believe it to be correct, which we now know, believe that it's really correct, then in that particular case, this light will not be a frame dependent quantity. So basically means that the relative formula, velocity formula that we have earlier talked about, it is not correct. Okay, I cannot add, at least it's not correct for velocity of light. All right, so it definitely requires certain modifications. So the classical formula of velocity addition is definitely not working here if postulates of Einstein are correct. A new formula is needed which will ensure that the speed of light is same in all the inertial frame of reference. So I need a particular formula which ensures that the light is same in all the inertial frame if this is correct. And also, not only that, this new formula must be consistent with the first postulate. And that's what Einstein started working on it, and that's what we are going to discuss in today's lectures and tomorrow lectures. Tomorrow's lecture, first we'll evolve a new formulation, a new relative velocity formula, which is consistent with the fact that speed of light should be same in all the frame of references. Okay. Second thing that I will test, whether this really works with the first postulate, whether this makes this particular formula is consistent with the first postulate of special theory of relativity, and whether any modifications are needed in our concept, then we will introduce those modifications, and then we will finally come to the most famous expression for Einstein, E is equal to mc square. So before I do that, let us just discuss certain concept, the concept of transformation. But this is something which we use very, very often in special theory of relativity. So what I mean by transformation? It basically means that a set of dynamical variables are known or measured for a particle in a given frame. For example, if you are, I mean, I have just now mentioned that there can be many inertial frame of references. You have one inertial frame of reference in which you have measured, let's say, the coordinate of a particular particle, or you have measured the velocity of a particular particle at a given time, or you have measured, let's say, acceleration at a given time. Okay, for example, acceleration could also be time dependent, or for that matter, you could have measured angular momentum or whatever it is. Any dynamical variable is measured in a given frame of reference at a given time. okay, if I want to know what will be exactly the same equivalent component in a different inertial frame of reference, the equations that I am going to use to obtain one from another are called transformation. So, let me first read, then I will explain a little more. A set of dynamical variables are known or are measured for a particle in a given frame. We are interested in finding out the values of the same set of variables in a different frame. The equations that we have to use are called transformation equations. So, for example, I may know Vx, Vy, Vz, which are the x, y and z component of velocity of a particle in a given frame. I want to find out what will be the velocity of the same particle as being seen in a different frame as prime. Okay, then the equations that I will use to convert this Vx, Vy, Vz to the velocities in a different frame of reference will be called velocity transformation equation. Or if I know what is the value of coordinate at a given time of a particular particle in a given frame, and I want to find out what will be the coordinate of the same particle at the same time in a different frame of reference, then the equation that I am going to use will be called the coordinate transformation equation. So, this is actually a simple concept, but we always use this for transformation. So, let us just I'd spend a few minutes to explain what is meant by transformation. So, for example, there are examples of transformation like coordinate transformation, velocity transformation. So, first what we will do, we will formalize the classical coordinate transformation, which probably all of us are knowing, may not be knowing in that formal language, but you know, unknowingly we have always been using it. So, let us just take the classical coordinate transformation, and then I will look what is required and what has to be done to change it to a consistent transformation with respect to the second postulate of Einstein. So, let us first talk of problem formulation. This I have mentioned in the last lecture also. Okay. While in the transparency which I had mentioned, what I have given last time, the set of axes were not very important because I was talking only of position vectors. Okay. But here let us be very, very clear, because I am talking about the coordinates. So, let us be very clear what are our choices of axes, and we are taking some sort of special choices of axes, but the transformation equations will be derived using those set of axes. But you can show very easily that, okay, if you want to use any general thing, I mean, you can always derive an equivalent type of equations, nothing of physics will change. Only thing, it makes our equation slightly simpler. So, I take two inertial frame, one is s and another s prime, choose x and x prime axis along the direction of relative velocity of the two frames. So, these two frames are both inertial. So, their relative velocity has to be constant. So, whatever is the relative velocity direction that I choose as my x direction and also x prime direction. Remember, x, y, z are the directions, x, y, z directions in s frame, x prime, y prime, z prime directions are the directions in s prime frame. So, once I know what is the relative velocity direction between two frames, I can always decide that my axis will be in that particular direction. All right. And the other person also decides, person sitting in S prime frame of reference, that whatever is the relative velocity direction, okay, corresponding to that, that person chooses X prime axis. So, X and X prime axis of both these frames are collinear, they are in the same line. Now, take two Z axis, two directions Y and Z, which are of course have to be perpendicular to X and also have to be mutually perpendicular. But then assume that S prime also has Y prime and Z prime axes parallel to it. As I said, this looks like some special case, but this is general enough, okay, and all the equations, it only makes your equations somewhat simpler. So, this is what I mean, I have two frames of references, S and S prime. So, S has axes X, Y and Z, this is axis X prime, Y prime and Z prime, okay, and I am assuming that this X and X prime are collinear, and Y and Y prime are parallel, Z and Z prime are parallel. We make two conditions. Again, these conditions are sort of general enough. Frame S prime moves with respect to S along the x axis with a velocity V, which I have always mentioned. Remember, here I am using the word V. Okay, I am emphasizing this particular aspect because now I have to be a little more careful. The velocity V, the symbol V is always reserved for relative velocities between the frame of reference. So, V is always supposed to be constant as a function of time. Whenever I am talking of a particle velocity, I will be using the symbol U. So, this one has to be very clear. V is the relative velocity between the frame, while both the observers could be observing a given particle, okay, and they could measure their velocity, and what velocity of that particular particle they will be measuring will be called U or U prime, depending upon whether it is being observed by S or S prime. The second condition which I impose is that I assume that both the observers have a clock, and obviously when they were moving like this relative to here, there would have been some time when O and O prime would have been coincident. Okay. When they were coincident, both the observers decided to start their stopwatch from 0 time. So, time 0 for both the observers S and S prime started from the time when their origins were coincident. So, clock of each observer is set to 0 time when their origins coincide, or rather coincided, alright. So, this is what we call as original transformation, classical transformation, which is called Galilean transformation. When I say direct transformation, it essentially means that I know x, y, z in S frame, and I want to find out what are x, y, z in S prime frame of reference. When I say inverse transformation, it means I know what are the x, y, z coordinates in S prime frame of reference. I have to find out what are the coordinates in x, y, z directions. Remember, here I am assuming that S prime moves along this particular direction with a velocity v. Now, according to an observer sitting here, this particular S frame goes away, recedes in this particular direction, minus x direction. So, if I change v to minus v, I should get exactly the same. We can transform from direct transformation to an inverse transformation. You can very easily see the Galilean transformation will be this, because if you are looking at one particular position here, something, y coordinate will be same because they are parallel. Similarly, the z coordinate will also be same. X coordinate will be different because the origin of this is differing from this particular thing by distance of vt, because they were coincident at t is equal to 0. So, at a time t, they will be far away from this particular thing, from each other by distance of vt. So, their x coordinates, these will be the x coordinates, these x coordinates will differ by an amount v times t. So, this is my direct transformation, which says x prime is equal to x minus vt, y prime is equal to y, and z prime is equal to z. Here, there is something which is implicit in the classical mechanics, which we have never been talking very, very loudly, okay, is that we also assume that the time remains same in both the frames of reference. So, once they have started the stopwatch, okay, whenever, I mean, an event happens, okay, both when both of them start observe an event, for example, could be observation of the location of a particular particle. Somehow we use always the concept of event in special theory of relativity. So, it could be, for example, observing an object. When we try to observe the object, okay, then the time, this particular event time for both of them will always remain same. So, t prime is equal to t. We never talk about it very clearly, but this is sort of implicit in all the classical mechanics that t prime is equal to t. So, these are what we call as Galilean transformation. Now, I can always calculate the classical velocity transformation. Okay, what you do, you differentiate with respect to time. If you differentiate with respect to time, it's as simple, you just differentiate with respect to time. So, here you will get vx prime, you differentiate this with respect to time, here you will get vx, because rate of change of x with respect to time will be v. When you differentiate this with respect to time, you will get v. Similarly, if I differentiate this with respect to time, I will just get vy prime, here I will get vy, vz prime, vz. So, if I differentiate with respect to time, this is what I will get, ux prime is equal to ux minus v, ui prime is equal to ui, uz prime is equal to uz, which is the same as the classical velocity addition formula. So, what I have found out is just classical velocity addition formula, which is the one which I had used when I was discussing the classical mechanics, the original idea that light will turn out to be frame dependent quantity. Obviously, this formula is not consistent with the second postulate of special theory of relativity, because if I keep on using this formula, I will always get velocity of light to be frame dependent. So, these are my comments. This is the same as the old relative velocity formula, which is inconsistent with the second postulate. We can always write inverse velocity transformation, okay, which will be ux is equal to ux prime plus v. So, remember, one can always obtain that inverse transformation from direct transformation by interchanging primed and unprimed quantities and replacing v by minus v. See, we generally try to write, I mean, there is nothing new about inverse transformation, but because relativity things can become somewhat complex. So, people find it easy to think in terms of direct transformation and inverse transformation, but even if you do not remember inverse transformation, all those things, as I said, can always be obtained from direct transformation. So, direct transformation is much more interesting. Now, we have to look for a transformation which is consistent with the second postulate, as we have said, that relativity rejects this particular transformation because this is not consistent with the second postulate of special theory of relativity. And therefore, we have to look for a new transformation which is consistent with the second postulate so that we get velocity of light frame independent. So, that is what I am going to discuss in my next lecture. So, I will stop here. We can have some questions because today we have some time for some questions. Balchand College, Sangli.
Questions are related to the Michelson Morley experiment.
Yes.
My first question is, yeah, you have used the term phase difference instead of path difference. What is the correct term there? Number two question is, you could not talk in your compensating plate is not shown in your diagram. Please explain the concept of compensating plate there. And last question is it possible to show actual practical experimental arrangement? Because in the original experiment, the Michelson and Morley used the mercury tank for carrying out the experiment.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. See, thing is that, you know, of course, I have not really talked about what exactly the experiment, the way we have they were doing, because that's not really of interest. I mean, my idea is to focus more on the physics aspect of it, and that's what I was emphasized on this particular thing. About the compensating plate, I'm probably they might have used, but you know, my idea was only to tell. Given the general philosophy of the experiment. Okay, now coming to your path difference and phase difference. See, path difference and phase difference are two different things, because path difference tells you exactly in the unit of distance. While when I'm talking the phase difference, it gives in the unit of the angle. Okay, so basically you have to look at the path difference and compare with the correspondingly convert into, let's say, a time difference, and eventually look that. I mean, I hope you understand what is the phase angle difference when I'm trying to draw. See, there is one particular wave like this. Okay, now this particular wave differs in the phase by, let's say, this particular wave. I'm sorry, I'm not drawing it very very good. Well, so whatever is the angle difference, okay. I mean, for example, if I am writing this A cos theta or cos kx minus omega t, another I write as k cos kx minus omega t plus phi. So, I am essentially interested in what is this phi. So, this is what I am calling as the phase angle difference. So, this is what I have calculated phase angle, but if you are not very comfortable with that, okay, basically you know how much additional path difference it has created, and you can also work out exactly the same thing using the path difference. Because I have been using this particular term right from quantum mechanics, kx minus omega t. So, I am little more comfortable myself with the phase angle, but if you are not very very comfortable, one can work out purely with path difference. It's just like any other interference experiment. You know Michelson was one of the great optics person who designed Michelson interferometer and things like that. So, for him to design and think about optics experiment was very, straightforward. So, he had designed this particular experiment by essentially taking the same concept of path differences, which is also being used in Michelson and interferometer. So, it is exactly the same thing. So, whatever is comfortable, that is alright. But basically the idea what I am trying to focus on, that generally if I am finding out, basically there are two things which I want to say, that if velocity of light is not same in all the inertial frame of reference and is constant and is given only in the ether frame of medium in terms of fundamental constants, in Earth's frame of reference, the velocity will be direction dependent. Velocity of light measured in different directions will turn out to be different in general. So, this is first aspect. And if this is so, then if I make light travel into two different directions which are perpendicular to each other, I will in general find out that there is going to be path difference. And this path difference would cause a shift in the fringes. The thing is that whether I am able to measure this fringe shift or not, and that is what he was trying to measure. He designed an experiment in a fashion where he could was really able to, whether he was sure that he could measure the fringe shift in case there was a path difference, okay, which he did not find.
I'm wondering whether I'm allowed to ask a question on crystallography, a topic that you dealt yesterday.
Yeah, please, you can.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Sir, we discussed about Bragg's law and diffraction of X-ray, and we had arrived at a condition of Bragg's law.
That's right.
My question is pertaining to that, sir, and I request you to elaborate on that.
Sure.
We always consider this Bragg's law as a Bragg's reflection also, maybe to certain extent Bragg's scattering also, and we say that whatever is the angle of incidence, the angle which incident X-ray makes with the plane,
That's right.
The same angle, it gets emerge also.
Yeah.
And on that hypothesis, we have built a relation.
That's right.
Sir, can you elaborate on to the reason why do you take that exactly the way it should be?
See, let's not talk about name, because people use different names depending upon, I say people are not very exact when we speak. We always feel that we understand. So somebody may call Bragg scattering, somebody may call Bragg reflection, somebody may call Bragg diffraction. Okay, all the three things are same as far as I am concerned, as far as 2D sin theta is equal to n lambda is concerned. All right. Of course, there could be also scattering which are called non-elastic scattering, which are very, very different, about which I have not talked. It's also possible that the part of the energy of the photon is used to excite some other excitation. In that case, the wavelength of the outgoing photon turns out to be different, which we call as inelastic scattering. So, in general, when we are talking of Bragg's law, we also call it elastic scattering, in which we always assume that the energy of the photon has not changed. All right. So, now what you can do, you can always take, for example, what you consider is scattering from one particular plane. If you consider from various planes, one particular plane, okay, if you take, let's say, this particular light, which is X-ray, which is coming in, and let's suppose it's not satisfying the condition of Bragg reflection, okay, it's going like this. So the angle, I'm looking at different planes. Okay, then you have another thing which is coming here and coming here, going like this. Then you can show that between these two beams, you know, if you are going this particular beam and this particular beam, the path difference between this beam and this beam will be different. Okay, so only when this angle and this angle turns out to be same from these particular planes, then only you will find that for scattering with all the atoms within this particular plane, there is no path difference. Okay, then only there is a possibility of a constructive interference. So first we consider one particular plane and we try to argue out that the thetas must be same. Okay, then we start taking the second plane and we say that in addition, the light which is coming, or the X-ray which is coming from here to here, the path difference, additional path difference which has come, which is because of this particular plane, which turns out to be 2T sin theta, should also be equal to n lambda. So first we consider take scattering only from one particular plane, and if we take this particular direction and let's say another beam which is going exactly in angle like this, which is not this particular angle, then you can draw a perpendicular here. Let me draw a much more clearer figure. So let's take only these two points. And let us suppose my X-ray is coming like this and it's coming like this. Okay, and let's suppose it's getting transmitted in an angle which is different from here. So let's say going like this. Okay, then you can calculate what will be the path difference. This path difference will be this. Okay, and between this to this will be the path difference. So this particular portion of the beam travels this particular distance larger, while this particular part of the beam travels this distance larger. This distance and this distance are not equal. So therefore, there will be additional path differences which will be created by these lines when you are taking scattering from different points. All right. Now, in order they are constructively interfering, then it is necessary that this path difference and this path difference should be exactly identical, which is only possible when this theta and this theta turns out to be same. So this is the first argument we do when we derive 2d sin theta is equal to n lambda. Okay. Unfortunately, I did not do the derivation of 2d sin theta is equal to n lambda, because we thought that is generally done even in high schools. So this is the first step of that, saying that condition of specular reflection must get satisfied in order that I get, you know, a constructive interference from one particular plane. Then I take additional second plane, and then I put additional condition 2d sin theta is equal to n lambda. I hope I have answered the question.
Last class you told,
yeah,
universe is a field of ether.
Beg your pardon?
At the initial stage of universe, what is the nature of ether?
Huh?
And what are the components of ether?
Yeah. See, you are asking what, I mean, of course, ether does not exist, so I cannot answer the question. See, at that time they thought, you know, I mean, that was also one of the problems about ether, because ether should be a very, very special medium, because, you know, if at all it was present, because it should have an excellent good transmittivity, because light keeps on coming from millions of light years away and they are still being observed on Earth. Okay, it was very, very difficult to envisage that particular medium. These were all the problems associated with the ether. So that's what I was telling, that people were not happy with the ether idea. But I mean, today I cannot talk about ether medium, that I, because I know that ether does not exist. It was only thought which was 110 years back.
Well, actually, light can travel in space with medium of ether, but it is a hypothetical medium.
That's correct.
But we can also assume that on the basis of particle, light can travel without medium.
I mean, that's what we believe now, that light can travel without medium. It doesn't require a medium to travel. That's precisely what I am trying to say, that, you know, the transparency which I put today essentially says that there is no ether medium. if we believe in postulates of special theory of relativity, which we do now, okay, in that case, ether does not exist and light does not require a medium to travel.
One more question, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, in relativity, frame S prime moves along quantitative x-axis. Can we assume in y-axis or z-axis, sir?
That's what I tried to answer today morning. Of course, you can always do it. The equations that I am going to get will become different. The Lorentz transformation, which I am going to not derive, but I am going to tell about Lorentz transformation in the afternoon lecture, okay, that will turn out to be different. Instead of x, there will be y. Instead of y, there will be z. That's all right. You know, I mean, it makes no difference. I mean, see, we have to choose some convention when we give the formula in the textbook. Okay, we have chosen this particular convention. Physics will never change if you change your x, y, z and axis, because x, y, z axis, okay, have been chosen by you. It has not been chosen by nature. Nature has not biased any particular direction to call it x direction. Okay, so whatever you are calling x direction, you could have called y direction. The equations will change. I mean, even if you would not have made y direction parallel to y prime direction, okay, you will get probably much more set of complicated equations. Okay, but physics will not change. The outcome has to be same. All right. Okay. Thank you. Have a nice lunch.